Hey folks, Chris Garlock back with Michael Redmond, 9-Don Professional, for our latest AlphaGo versus the world. We've got a little bit of an interesting one for you this time. We have a new player and something interesting with the opening, and I think we're going to get into a little of the middle game for a change, right?
Yeah, I'm going to go a bit further in this game. The player is Weon Seongjin from Korea. He was born in Seoul in 1985, so I guess that makes him in his 30s at the time of this game.
Wow, old man.
And yeah, in this group, yeah. And he won the Samsung Cups in 2011, so he's a world champion. I think I remember playing him before that when he was still young. And like, I didn't really know who he was at the time. And yeah, he creamed me. I remember that. I just remember it was pretty ugly.
Okay. But you're okay.
I have the impression that he's a very strong fighting player. But actually, in this game, he's going to play a fairly good opening. He's going to hold up against AlphaGo in the opening. So let's take a look.
Let's take a look.
So Weon Seongjin has black. He's playing 3-4 points. And he slides. Like, that's a move that is not played very much anymore. And you're supposed to play some kind of a corner enclosure in the upper left. And he plays the 3-3 point. You're not supposed to play that one either. And so these are probably bad, but I have the feeling that when you have the black stones, the damage done by this kind of move, according to the computer analysis, is not as big as if you have white. Like, if you have white, then the initiative you lose by playing these low moves, like, computer programs do not like moves on the second line, like this slide here. And moves that are not forceful. They're not attaching against an opponent's stone, so it's easy for white to play away. And then this 3-3 point, there were a couple of other games in which a similar shape arised, and AlphaGo pretty constantly just ignores any potential attack against this white group. And it never really works out. So we see some of the top players playing this and trying to attack that white group. It doesn't really work out very well for black.
Mm.
And so at this point, it is slightly better for white. Like, white is supposed to have a 51% winning percentage. 51%, that's not so big. Like, it did start out with black having a slight advantage at 6.5-point komi. So white has gained a little bit, but it's not something that I would be noticing. And white continues here. Black plays the attachment underneath. When black plays this joseki, black's score, given by the AIs, you might say, black's score is not going to go down very much. This is considered an okay joseki for black to play. It almost always gets a good score from a computer program. And I'm talking about computer programs that use the AlphaGo algorithm and those neural networks. Black plays here. This is a move that could have been played like this, that goes into a completely different variation where white is probably going to play here. It's going to get into a little fight there. Actually, we saw a couple of games in which black did try to attack this shape after playing these two moves in the corner, taking away white's eyes. And I'll show you that variation again. It's just that viewers might enjoy trying to find the games I'm talking about. But there were some games in which I'll try to put some links in the video when it's published. But there were some games where black failed to see this move. The crawling move, black would be playing moves like the slide or sometimes covering here. I think black was playing different moves and they didn't really work out for black. Turns out crawling here is a very powerful move. And if white connects there, black can go after this one stone on the lower side. So this kind of variation actually would be locally relatively good for black. Compared to the game. And it's something I talk about in the other files, and I will be going into more detail in the book, of course.
Mm-hmm.
In the game, black starts here. This is also a fairly good move. And even just talking in context of the score a computer program will give it, is still okay. Black, you can see black has a lead in territory. If black plays here next, black's going to have all four corners. So black's going to have a lot of territory compared to white. So he's playing a style that was actually pretty popular at the time. and white slides here. And, you know, both players at this in this sequence here, both players are playing what are the recommended moves most of the time by a computer program, like, for instance, Lee Lazaro. But this is a move, actually, that was not liked very much. It did give white a slight extra advantage. And Lee was suggesting, Lee Lazaro, that is, was suggesting black invade here. This was actually black's last chance to invade the upper side.
Wow.
And if something like this happens, it's very dangerous for white. It's dangerous for white also, and the focus sort of goes, switches to the right side. And that's a rather complicated variation. I'm not going to go into it. It's probably better for white to play an attachment on top. But then, of course, black gets the territory like this. Something like this could happen. It's not as if that there's going to be a very serious attack against black in the upper left. So black is establishing a territorial lead. So this would be still close to even. In the game, black plays here. This exchange, it gave white the territory here. So yeah, white seems to have a slight advantage at this point. Black reduces the white territory. And this is still, it's pretty close to the optimal move. And this move also was chosen by Lee Lazaro. So he's doing fairly well here. He's keeping very close to 50%. Although there were some mistakes I mentioned. They were not sort of lethal mistakes. They were not big mistakes. This is where he finally does make a mistake. And the correct move is pretty amazing. The move that was played was he played here. It looks such a natural move. And white took advantage of that by playing these two forcing moves. And the clunky thing about black's wall here is all of these stones, they're not touching white on the upper side. They're not as effective as they could be. Mm-hmm. In fact, white is getting these two extra forcing moves from this side, which are going to help white when white starts to attack black on the lower side. So although black added a stone there to make a thick shape, a strong shape, the extra forcing moves that white got on the outside are pretty effective also when white is taking the initiative on the lower half of the board. And so this move actually was a slack move. And it was a very natural looking move that easily I could have played too. The fact that it turns out to be a slack move, it becomes sort of obvious after white plays this exchange, yeah, which did not pop to mind immediately, but it was very effective. And the answer to that, what should black have done with this move, is fascinating, because black plays here. And if white answers here, black plays here, you can see black is playing much more forcefully, threatening to play an atari here and fix his shape. So if white continues with this move, black's going to play a double hane. Again, an atari here would be a very valuable forceful move. It means white has to continue. White has to continue with this. White has to continue with this. Black's going to get a nice solid position there on the right with the initiative. Black has sente. Black can play something on the lower side.
It is. Okay, I've been looking for that. Yeah. Wow. That
does not actually connect up to the group on the left here. This group is going to be able to manage itself. It has moves like this in the corner or this on the side. And probably starting from the side, the combination of this move with the threatened hane at g18 or the attachment in the corner, black should be able to handle these stones. So he doesn't really have to, it's not mandatory that black connects up in the center. So when white does that, black can switch to the lower side. This would have actually been a really neat way to play it. Would have been beautiful.
Mm-hmm. It's gorgeous.
Just finding this move. And then there's the question, what if white plays here to prevent that? And that was fascinating too, because black jumps here. Now black is threatening to squeeze with this cut. So if white plays away, let's just have white play some random move. Black can squeeze like this. And so black has this, the thickness is so much better than it was in the game, with all those forcing moves.
Mm-hmm.
So this move was slack, and it's pretty obvious that it was not the best move when white does this, but seeing how black should have played was not easy. So that was impressive. I was very impressed by the results I was getting with a computer. And when white plays here, the game is already something like 57% for white, mm-hmm. So black's only winning by a few points on the board. And black had to play strongly here. Like, this takes a lot of, it's going to be difficult to execute anyway. In the game, black played here. White played this exchange. And it's starting to look fairly good for white. Like, it's white's above 60%. Black is probably still going to be winning by a little bit before Comey. But black has this lousy connection here. The two-space jump is not completely connected. Black probably has to back off something like this. And although black, you know, probably will win before Comey, it's not really a happy situation for black. And this is where he sort of broke, because at this point, black played here, and this was an overplay. From here on, it's going to be a massacre, because white just plays like this and it's going to cut black off. And it was a pretty much forced sequence in which white is just going to capture that black group on the lower side. And everything black tries in counterplay is just not going to work. And so it's after this, it just gets very bloody. But it was amazing. I was impressed by the way he kept in the game for like the first 50 moves. He was very close to 50%. And that's, as far as I remember, that was the best result in the whole series. He only was a world champion once, so maybe he's a less known player, but it was a very impressive performance, if you ask me, by Weon Seongjin.
Just before we wrap up, I'm just curious, because he did play such a lovely, lovely opening. And like you said, just you know, hanging in there, you know, getting really, really far. Do you think it was just sort of missing that direction of play with that really nice sequence where instead of, you know, being out there in the center, you know, very, as you show, very easy to handle, just miss that? Or what do you think happened there?
Well, you know, this is such a natural looking move. And in a 30-second game, starting this move and finding this move instead, this is the kind of move, like, I wouldn't be surprised to see a player like Honinbo Dosaku or Go Seigen, those players who we call Go Saints, or the geniuses, maybe that player would play a move like this. And we would work it out maybe and figure out how it was working. Very few players in the history of Go play moves like this. And so this is a move that really was very special for me, just to see this move suggested by computer programs. And without AlphaGo playing this sequence that immediately sort of refuted Black's move there, I wouldn't have even had the question. So the whole sequence here from move 50, just a few moves from 50 to 55,
yeah,
where the game, just the color of the center of the board changed from black to white, sort of. Was very impressive. And the answer that I got for what Black should have done was impressive.
Well, which goes to the reason that, and I have to say, you know, when we had talked about this, and, you know, my original, you know, thought was that, you know, we would choose some of the sort of the key games. And when you said you wanted to do all 60 games, I was like, ooh, I don't know. But I mean, as you've been showing, each game, you know, they're almost like, rough cut gems, you know, each one of them. I remember when we did the first commentaries, and you know, you were often amused because the games were effectively over so soon. And it's been really fun going back and seeing there's a whole lot of stuff going on here, isn't there?
Well, yeah, they're the best players in the world. You have to expect some neat stuff happening.
Great stuff, Michael. Thank you so much. Thank you all for watching, and we'll see you next time.